That's good. Okay. Today is Sunday, September 18th, 2016, and this is
You have to speak louder, son.
And this is the beginning of an interview with, what's his name?
Dean.
Dean Van Landeringham at the VFW Veterans Village in Fort McCoy, Florida. My name is Tommy Hurst, and I'll be the interviewer. Also present is Samuel Karkowski, and he will operate the video. Could you tell us your full name and address?
Pardon?
Could you tell us your full name and address? Could you tell us your full name and address?
Oh, my full name is Dean Van Landeringham. The address here is Fort McCoy.
Where and when were you born?
In a metropolis of called Scott, Ohio, which was so large, if you took two deep breaths as you went by, you missed it. It was about the size of Fort McCoy.
How old are you today?
Will be 96 next Tuesday.
Who were your parents and what were their occupations?
Well, my dad started out as a farmer and ended up as a steel worker in Detroit, Michigan.
Did you have any siblings?
I have one sister, one half-brother, and one stepsister.
What were their names?
Pardon?
What were their names?
Glendine was my sister, Ramona was my stepsister, and Charles was my half-brother.
Did any of your siblings serve in the military?
Not during the war time.
What were you doing before you entered the service?
I was in college.
What were you studying?
Physics.
At what school?
Pardon?
At what school?
Hillsdale College, Hillsdale, Michigan.
When did you enter the service?
I went back to college, became an engineer for a consumer's power company in Michigan, got bored stiff doing, and so I went into education, taught a couple of years, then was taken to University of Western Michigan, where I trained teachers, educated a few, then became a high school principal.
Which branch of service did you serve in?
The Army, 26th Infantry, World War II.
Did you enlist or were you drafted?
I enlisted, yeah.
Why did you enlist?
Because I was American and I was a scout and I thought I could help, and I'd rather do that than fiddle around doing nothing.
Why did you choose the Army?
I wanted to be a pilot, and got into a cadet school, got into flight school, got into intermediate flight training on a place called Debbie B. Flying Field outside of Oklahoma City, and we got caught in a sandstorm. That was back when the sandstorms were going on. And there was 100 planes in the area, and everybody down. Well, 100 planes trying to land on two runways. My plane didn't make it. And killed the pilot, and strained my back. I was taped up from ear to ear for about 6 weeks. And that was the end of my flight training.
Where did you serve?
All over the country, and went into Europe at Utah Beach, and served all the way through France, Belgium, the Battle of Bulge, and got wounded in the Battle of Bulge.
Where did you receive your basic training?
That's crazy, I never had it. From what I observed in being in the Army and being in combat, my Boy Scout training was a lot more valuable to me than when the basic training was to these other guys. I grew up with a scoutmaster. We camped, took hikes and camped about every 3 weeks. And I've gone out camping when it was raining, snowing, everything else. And if our mothers would have said, you can't go, we'd have pitched a fit. But that was just okay at that time. Nowadays, if you're scouting and you want to go on a camping trip and it looks like rain, Mama's not going to let most of you go. We grew up in a time when you're kind of rough and ready.
What weapons did you qualify on during training?
Well, as an expert in everything. Pistol, rifle, and bayonet and everything else.
What qualification level did you achieve?
Pardon?
What qualification level did you achieve?
Qualification number?
Level.
Well, I was classified as an expert with weapons. But as far as any qualification in those days, you were just a soldier, period. And you did your duty and got your training, and that was it.
What was your military specialty?
I was a policeman, military policeman. Our job was, we were what they called a combat group, and we were assigned to the 26th Infantry. And in the States, we were just policemen. You keep all the guys out of the red light districts. And he's too young to know what that is. But then we got overseas. Our job was to be right with the troops and make sure they had the equipment and stuff was coming up that they had to use. And I had to be right with the combat, although I was not. When they made an attack, I was not in the first line of attack. I was in about the fourth line to make sure that everything was, all the equipment and the aid men had their stuff that they needed. And wasn't any fun, son. No fun at all.
Did you receive any special training?
No. Well, we had the military police, we were constantly being trained about different things that might happen. But it was no great command decisions or anything like that. We were just policemen.
Do you remember any of your instructors?
Pardon?
Do you remember any of your instructors?
Yeah, some of them. Some were pretty nice guys. Some of them I would soon shoot as look at, but
how did you adapt to military life?
Except for combat, it wasn't bad.
Were you married or were you single?
I was single.
What do you remember about physical regimen?
Pardon?
What do you remember about physical regimen?
Physical what?
Regimen.
Regiments? I'm not sure I know what you mean by that.
What do you remember about the barracks?
They were just places to sleep. And they were just, in those days, they were all prefabricated and put together rather quickly. And they held they were about 50 foot long. You entered this area here, and one platoon would be on this side, the other platoon would be on this side, and the bathrooms were outside down in a room, which we called the latrine. And that was a separate thing. Well, you went to the bathroom, we went down to get showered. That was a separate building. The barracks were just, in the Air Corps, we had two tiers, metal beds. In the infantry, it was just cots. They were metal cots, but they weren't anything fancy.
What do you remember about the food? What do you remember about the food?
It was just army food. It wasn't too bad. I mean, you were hungry, so you ate it. And fortunately, my company had two darn good cooks. One of them was a guy named Teddy Leclerc. He was a professional wrestler. And they made a company clerk out of him. But he was a good guy, and it was not too bad.
Where did you serve?
All over Europe. I went in at Utah Beach, across through San Lo to Paris, across to pretty close to the German border. Then we got called back to get reinforcements. Then the Battle of the Bulge broke loose, and we got shipped up there and dumped out in the snow about as deep as this here. And nobody knew where the Germans were, but they were in that direction. And our orders were to keep moving until you met the Germans. And we met them at a place called Grospis in Luxembourg. It was just a small town. We came up, it was quite hilly in that area. We came up on this hill, and there was a little valley here, and as we came up on the hill, look down there, and here the Grospis was a town. Oh, I don't know how big, probably 500 or 600, just full of German tanks and German troops. And that's where we met them. And from then on, we just kept pushing, pushing, pushing. And it was cold, and miserably cold. If a guy got wounded and we couldn't get him out quickly, he would freeze to death. And there's an article in was on History Channel the other night. This was not my outfit, but he was up in the northern part of the Bulge, and it had rained and everything, and snow and cold. And he, in the foxhole, in the morning he woke up, got up, he couldn't move because his feet were in water about that deep, and it was frozen. Both feet were frozen.
What are some memories of going overseas? What are some memories of going overseas?
Of going overseas?
Yeah.
It was just a long trip. We went over in a converted coffee boat called the John R. McAndrew. And it was a coffee boat that came from Brazil up to New Orleans. And you could smell the coffee on it. And Colonel Hill was the commanding officer of all of us. We got on the boat in Fort Shanks from New York. Got on the boat, went by the Statue of Liberty. And he said, listen up, listen up, listen up. There will be no gambling on this boat, period. No gambling. We don't tell a bunch of GIs, don't do something. And so we got in a fantail and started gambling. And we were there for about an hour, I guess, and all of a sudden we looked up and here there was a colonel. We popped to. He started chewing us out about the fact that we were gambling. And we had a corporal with us, Corporal Puskas. He said to Colonel, Colonel, we're not gambling. He said, Van here's a science, physics major. He's teaching us the law of probabilities. So I could see the Colonel, he had to bite his teeth. So he wouldn't laugh. He turned around and left us alone. But I never saw him before or after, but he was the artillery commander for our division. And then we got outside of that. It was just a pleasant boat ride. We had destroyers around us. We had planes from a small flat top that were not big planes. They were just what we called grasshoppers, that single-wing observation planes. They would take off and look for submarines, but we never saw anything. We had a very quiet drive all the way over.
Were you issued any special equipment?
No.
How did you feel witnessing casualties or destruction?
Pardon?
How did you feel witnessing casualties or destruction?
I didn't get the last part.
How did you feel witnessing casualties or destruction?
Well, when you've been with a bunch of guys for pretty close to a year, they become real close friends. And to see one of them get hit or killed, it hurts like hell for when it first happens. But after about 2 months, you get so tired, you become almost hypnotized. And it doesn't seem to bother you too much after that. You just expect it. You're just wondering when your time is coming. You just get in a position that it's got to be done. You do it. No question about it. You just hope you do whatever's right. And you hope you can conduct yourself so that your parents won't be ashamed or your friends back home won't be ashamed of anything you did. And you don't go in with a heroic attitude. You don't want to charge the elephant by yourself. But it's not a pleasant experience, son. I got a lot of good friends, and I remember them that are still over there. And it burns me when I see some of these guys making millions of dollars a year playing football or basketball that won't stand up when the national anthem is played. Those guys to me are just scum. They have no right to be free if they're not going to stand up and try it. And I've written an awful lot of essays over the period of years about constitutional rights. And if you're going to be an Eagle Scout, get that Constitution and read it. It's basically a set of principles by which we should live. And I was talking to one of our men here today. You know what freedom is? That's an easy word to describe. But why didn't the Constitution say citizen life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? Why didn't it say life, freedom, and the pursuit of happiness? Why in law is it life, law, and liberty? Why do we call it the Statue of Liberty? Why did Patrick Henry say, give me liberty or give me death? Why didn't he say freedom? Start thinking, you got to think real deeply, not about the baloney that comes on the TV. And this particular election campaign, it's the lowest group of people I've ever, and I'm 97 now, and it's the lowest group of people I've ever seen running our country. It has nothing to do with Republicans or Democrats. It's the individual. You have certain inalienable rights. What are they? Life, liberty? What does liberty mean? Now, we pretty well accepted the fact that you and you, your dad and I, are individuals, you and I had absolutely nothing to say about being alive today, being born. We had nothing to say about it. We were non-existent at the time. Your dad and your mother made a decision. And with that decision, they had the freedom to make that decision. But with that decision, if you look at liberty and freedom, they had the freedom to make that decision. But liberty says you have that freedom, but you have the responsibility for your own decisions. Nobody can make them for you. You're going to be bombarded with all kinds of forces, TV forces, political forces, economic forces. But in the final decision, what you want to do with your life and how you live your life is yours, nobody else. There'd be a time your dad now has assumed that responsibility, and he'll continue to assume it until you get to the become a mature adult yourselves. Then it's your freedom to decide your own life. But you must accept the decision of what you're going to do. You can't blame Dad because he didn't tell me about something that's going to happen 20 years from now. It's your decision. And that goes all the way from almost all of the things you hear the people arguing about in politics. Abortion, life. Is that the business of the government? You have the right to freedom of assembly. Yet, when we have an assembly, the Black Lives Matters can come in and completely disturb your rights to be at that assembly peaceably. Does the media say anything about that? Huh? They don't understand what liberty really means. Okay, keep on going.
What action did you witness? What action did you witness?
All kind of action in the service, in the army, and in combat. Artillery, tanks, airplanes, bombs, everything else. And I'm just fortunate to be still walking, or not walking, but still being alive. And,
what was it like being under enemy fire? What was it like being under enemy fire?
You're scared, 100% scared. Somebody's trying to kill you, and you can't run.
If you were not on the front lines, what were your duties?
Well, when you got back in reserve, you just relaxed to get your strength back. That's what it was for. You didn't do anything.
Did you admire your commanding officer?
Pardon?
Did you admire your commanding officer?
Our general was General Paul, who was within probably 200 or 300 yards of the front line many, many times. I saw him several times. And you could hear the rifle fire coming up from over the hill. And we all respected him. Of course, under Patton, nobody knew who he was, his old blood and guts. But I had some real fine men who were officers who said, "We're in this together, let's do it right." And they treated us with dignity, he treated us with respect. I had some that were just plain scum. They had the brass, and boy, they were up. We were just dirt to them. Well, there's a lot of those that are over there under the ground that the Germans didn't shoot.
Did you admire the people you served with?
Oh, yeah. I kept track of those that... I think now there's only one left of my group. He's a kid named Bob Fraser, Robert Fraser. We used to call him Brenda in training or in the States. He became a lawyer and became on the state of Washington Supreme Court. We corresponded about once a year. And he's now retired. But he got shot in the leg, and but he's the only one that I can recall that is still alive. And I'm not sure he's alive because I haven't heard from him since last Christmas. And, the other good friend that I had was from Prestonburg, Kentucky. He was about as 3 inches taller than you are, and. He became a policeman in Kentucky, then went into real estate and became pretty wealthy. And he died last spring. And that's the last one that, as far as I know, Bob is the only one left. And I get my division reunion, and all the fellas that I knew that joined the reunion, they're all gone. I get now the thing, I don't recognize any of the names.
How did you stay in contact with your family back home?
Yes, speak much louder, son.
How did you stay in contact with your family back home?
Oh, through email. And that was at overseas when I was in the States, I'd just call them. And but we got overseas, they had this thing called a V-mail, which was a piece of paper. You wrote maybe 50 words, and it would be mailed for you. You didn't have to, there was no postage that was required.
What did you do when you were off duty? What did you do when you were off duty?
Well, most of us would... just sit around and shoot the bull. When we got a chance to get in town, we would walk around, go around and see what it was. The guys I was with, the particular group that was closer to me, about six of us, we didn't drink. Well, we'd get to someplace, get a glass of beer. But too many of the guys would go and from the bus directly to the bar and get about two-thirds souse before they got through. And so every payday, those guys, they went three or four old National Guard sergeants that as soon as they got paid, these sergeants would be in line there and they'd make those guys pay them back what they'd loaned them. They'd all go down into the latrine and start shooting craps. And within 2 days' time, this gambling group, the sergeants had all their money. And those guys were in trouble all the rest of the day. I mean, they'd go into town, but they didn't have any money to spend. They were always trying to borrow money from somebody else. But my group wouldn't loan them anything because they just wasted. And we'd know we'd never get paid back.
Did you get enough sleep? Did you get enough sleep? While you were...
You mean when?
When you were overseas.
When you're near combat or in combat or where you could get under artillery fire, they butter you up with one other guy. And during the night, half of the group are awake. The other half can take a snooze. 2 hours later, they wake us those up. And they take 2 hours off, and the other group are watching. Half of the guys have to be awake all the time, because the Germans, and we did too, would do have night attacks, and you'd go out on patrol, and if you were on patrol, you didn't get any sleep at all. You left as soon as it got real dark, and if you didn't get back before it got light, you probably were dead. I weighed about 185 pounds going into service, and when I got to the hospital in England, I only weighed 158. I had lost almost 40 pounds in combat, and all of them did. You never got the rest, you never got the food to read when you were. We had what they called sea rations, which were cans about that big around. One of them was full of what they called meat and vegetable hash, which was nothing more than ground beef and potatoes. The other one had two crackers like that, which were, we called them hardtack. They were hard as rocks. And there would be cheese in there, and two pieces of candy, and a packet of four cigarettes. Otherwise, you got what they called the K-ration. It was about that long, about that wide, about that thick, which had one small can of was some kind of beef. The other can was cheese, and there was a couple pieces of candy and four cigarettes in it. That's all we had in combat to eat. And when we got back on for R&R, rest and relaxation, which may only be 2 or 3 days, then you'd get they'd warm these things up, because we got them, particularly in the Battle of Bulge, they were froze.
Where were you when the war ended?
I was in just outside of Ipswich, England, with the 92nd Air Force Bombardment Group. After I got wounded, this was the 20th of January in 45. They sent me to the hospital in France, then they sent me to a hospital in England, and I was there from about January 25th, February, March, April. I was in the hospital there for 3 months. Then they sent me back to a convalescent place in France, assigned to the Air Corps. The Air Corps didn't want us over there, a bunch of privates and infantry. So they sent us back to England. I got sent to the 92nd Bombardment Group. And I was there, then I got sent home. It was about the middle of July in 45, and they gave me a month's furlough. Then I had to go back in to Sioux Falls, South Dakota Air Base, and I was there from September, October, November 10th, 5th, I was there 3 months. I got stuck by working in the discharge center. And we'd go through the guy's records, call him in, ask him if that was it, put him on discharge center, give them the thing to go over to the chapel. And 50 of them would get in there, and then they'd have some kind of a service. And then he'd put them on a bus and take them to the train. And there was about 250,000 men on that base. We're discharging them. 50 at a group would go through, but we're charging more than 50 at a time. They're probably 1,000 a day were being discharged. But it was kind of a mess. It was really crowded. It was a small air base. I took my wife out there in 40, well, it was 52, to show her where the air base was. It's a cornfield now. There was at that time. But,
when did you return back home?
Pardon?
When did you return back home?
Well, they sent me back, I don't know just what day it was I got back to the States. But I got back to my family, I think the last week in August. No, not August, last week in July. Because my furlough was supposed to be the 1st of August till the 1st of September. So they sent me then to Sioux Falls. They sent me right back home, and I had to go back to Sioux Falls, and I finally got discharged to come home.
How long were you overseas?
Oh. I think it was a year and 3 months. About roughly a year and three months.
What did your family think about you going into the Army?
Everybody had to go. All the guys my age, if you're single, you had to go, period. It started out, we enlisted because I wanted to be a flyer. But very shortly after that, the draft, and everybody between the ages of 18 to 42 had to register for the draft. Everybody went, if you're that age, unless you were completely physically unable. And then they classified you what they 4F, which meant physically you couldn't do anything.
How did you adjust to civilian life?
It wasn't hard. I just went back to college. And there was a bunch of guys there who were former GIs, and went back and lived in a private home with six other guys. They were all former GIs. One of them was in the Army as a veterinarian. One guy was in the Navy. Lyle was also in the Army, and here in the, yeah, that was it, I guess. But they were, the fellows were all, six of us were veterans. We lived in a private home because we didn't want to live in a dormitory. We'd had enough of that.
What have you done since leaving the military?
Well, I worked for a while with Consumers Power Company in Jackson, Florida, or Jackson, Michigan, and as a junior engineer. And it was the most boring work I ever did in my life, because you sit around three-fourths of the time, they give you a little dinky thing to do, a little dinky thing to do, a little dinky thing to do. So I finally said, that's it. So I went back to college, and I had been in scouting. I thought I'd like to become a professional scouter. And we had a fellow named Earl Silvers, who was the professional scouter in charge of our whole district in Detroit and Wayne County. And so I went down and talked to him about becoming a professional scouter. But in those days, it was entirely different than it is now. So I just went back to college, and after I got through and got bored stiff with being an engineer, I got married. My wife was a nurse, and we just started talking, and she said, well, why don't you go back in education, because you used to work with kids all the time. So I did, and I became a teacher of math and science. and went to a place called Big Rapids, Michigan, which was a real, real nice town. And I was there 2 years, and I got a telephone call one night. They wanted me to come back down to University of Western Michigan in Kalamazoo. And what was this? Well, they want me to come. They wanted me to come down. They wanted me to get back on the faculty. So Kalamazoo was only about 22-23 miles from where my wife grew up. So we went back down, and they offered me the job of what they called as a critic teacher, assistant professor of education. And so I had a group of kids that I was responsible to teach, but if you were potential teachers, you were also my students. And after I got the thing started, I would turn it over to you to certain things we talk about, what you're going to try to do, what you're going to try to do. And I wouldn't let you lecture. And in science class, half the time in science class, I took the kids to the library to do research. And in math classes, I started what they called individualized instruction, which was not popular. After I do the formal teaching, like algebra, just like if you have algebra in school, you know what the first 6 weeks were. In fact, the whole year was a teacher explaining something. Did you get it? Test you to see if you got what I taught you. Well, I didn't do it that way. First 2 weeks, same. Give a test. You got the test, bam, you got 100 on it. You flunked it. What are we going to do? Shall we do a review? Yeah, you want a review. You don't understand it. You understand it. Why should you sit there and go back over the stuff you already know? And the kids taught me how to teach kids. And finally one kid said, why can't we go at our own speed? I started thinking about my work in scouting. How come I got a group of kids in my platoon? Couple of them zoom, 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 zoom right up to first class. A couple other ones never got beyond second class. How come? Well, there's all kind of factors, I guess, that do this. So I turned them loose. What I would do then, knowing that you were at this point, because if you understand math, it's you go this way for a while, then there's all kind of deviations you can do to solve the problem. It's not one. You were taught one basic way to solve problems in arithmetic and in mathematics. There's dozens of ways of doing it. That's what bothers me today about education. We are funneling rather than broadening. So it turned them loose. And you were here. I would throw a problem on the board. I had an overhead projector, so I could put it on that and observe what was happening. Okay, John, come up here. What's the first thing you do? I'll tell the class why you're doing it. Okay. Pete, you're at this level. Come up here and show us what you're going to do next. And finally, get down here. I can remember this girl, she was about 5'8", skinny as a dickens, thin as a rail. She couldn't add 6 and 6 and come up with something but 66. And she would sit there and cry, I don't understand it, I don't understand it. But she was in a band and played the flute. So I got a hold of her and said, Sharon, I don't know one tune from another. You are a terrific flutist in the band. So don't worry about math. If I had to take music, I'd flunk it completely. So what difference does it make? You concentrate on what you can do best. Don't worry about it. You won't fail. I'm not going to fail you. Just try to learn a little bit. Well, she never got beyond the sixth week in ninth grade algebra. But I had a kid named Jimmy Dunham, who, when I got him, the teachers who had him as an elementary student said, he's just going to raise holy hell in your class. He had a record that thick. Now, they weren't nasty, but he was constantly disturbing and asking questions. He had an IQ of 168, borderline genius. I turned him loose. He went through ninth grade algebra, advanced algebra, trigonometry, physics, college calculus as a ninth grader. At the end of his sophomore year, he raised so much cane in the geometry class that we got him into the University of Chicago. They had a program for advanced students. He got a PhD in mathematics at the age of 19. The possibility of things happening are terrific if we free this knot head up here. Your brain doesn't go this way. Your brain does this. You know what an amoeba is, don't you? You ever watched it in water through the microscope? The tentacles are going here, out here, up here, down. It's searching for food. That's the way the brain is working. It's out here. Look at here, look at here, look here. It's constantly looking for things to learn. But if you shut it off and say, no, we're going to keep it in this little level here, that's why we got all the national and international problems. People do not understand the whole mechanism of being human. So when you get your degree, read everything. Don't read, here I'm a physicist. What am I doing reading some of the stuff that I read? I don't know, I just read it. Why have I read practically all what the devil they call them? I'm getting to the point where I'm losing certain words in my vocabulary. But I read all of the old myths and things from way back when. Some of them don't make any sense, but I've read them. And go back and read Aristotle. Read those guys way back then. They were some of the first people who dared to think beyond the limits. Socrates, go back and find something, read about him. One of the things I read, I think, was Socrates stated that man's experience is pretty much determined by what he sees. He was saying that if we took a group of people, set them down against a wall, and behind them we had a fire with people doing things, all of these people down here that could see in that wall was the shadows. That's the only thing they ever saw until they were turned loose. What would be their perspective on what is life? Their minds would be, see, your mind keeps developing. It's at your age, it's still developing and will develop until about the age of 23, 24, 25. Because certain sections up in here don't develop as rapidly as other ones. And if you don't develop these, this thing up in here is never going to get developed. And so your intelligence that you had the possibility is gone. You've got to keep that mind working constantly. So I think I got started with thinking like this in what you're doing now as you're earning your ego. Because I had to go into all kind of merit badges that I never even dreamed existed. And I had a scoutmaster who didn't let me just read the pamphlet and asked me about the pamphlet and give me the thing. I had to go out and do it. When I got bird study, I had to go out and listen to those birds. Now, I didn't have any tape recorder, but I had to get close enough to those birds and sketch them as why they were different than this bird, why this one was different than this one. It took me dead burn near a year. Now, I didn't do nothing but bird study, but that, it took me a year to get that done. Nowadays, I know certain troops were reading the study of this pamphlet. I don't know whether they still have them or not. They used to have a pamphlet for every merit badge. You read the pamphlet, and then somebody would ask you questions about it. If you passed it, you got the merit badge. I got a merit badge in architecture. What in the Sam Hill did I just do that for? I don't know. But I got interested in somehow or other, so I started digging into it. We had an architect in town that was given the responsibility of determining whether anybody would get the badge or not. Boy, he made me read books after books after books after books. I had to be able to identify the various phases of architecture throughout the period of time. It took me about 3 months to get that darn badge. See, there's a difference in perspective as to what life's all about. And if we can broaden our thinking about it, it's going to put you in a spot where you'll be kind of ignored sometimes by people who can't think beyond the end of their nose. You'll find that. But inside, you're going to feel what you've done with your life, what you can do the best. And, the happiest people I ever knew in my life was when I was at the training school there at the Western Michigan training teachers. I had a colored boy and a colored girl in class, the only two colored kids I had in that class. And they were as poor as Job's turkeys, but they were nice kids. They weren't too sharp. And so one day I got talking to them, because I always made a point to talk to every kid I had in the class individually. And I asked him, "Billy, what do you think you want to do?" He said, "I want to be a truck driver like my dad." I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, when he gets back home, nobody bothers us. We go out fishing, we go on picnics, we go out hunting together." So I said, "I'd like to meet your dad." So I went out to meet him one time. They lived in a small house. And got in the door, there was no rooms in it. But the rooms were up there, but they were just 2x4s. She had taken sheets, separated the rooms off. And that was the only thing that differentiated that from just a big space. But they were the two or the four of the happiest people I've ever known in my life. He was just a truck driver for the county. So, but every life is important. Okay, son, sorry. I get off on a tantrum on it because I'm not a minister by far.
How did your wartime experience affect your life?
You have to speak good enough.
How did your wartime experiences affect your life?
They made me more intense about what I'm trying with just talking here. Makes me more intense to try to get people to think deeply. If we think deeply and understand the forces that affect you and affect you, what made you you? What made you you? Why do you think this way? Why do you think about this way? And if I can get somebody to think more deeply, then those guys that I know over there, I will have made up a little bit for them, I hope. And that's why I do it. I have no desire to do otherwise. Because I have too many friends that are over there under crosses.
Did you have post-traumatic stress?
Well, not as they normally claim it, but you got to the point where you were so keyed up to sounds and things like that that you reacted to it instantly. If you didn't, you were dead. For example, when I was back doing my master's degree, there was a fellow there who was a captain of the infantry in Italy. He and his wife, and my wife and I, became pretty good friends. We went to a movie one night called A Walk in the Sun. It was a movie about a squad of infantrymen in Germany, in Italy. And most of it was just Hollywood bunk. But they came upon a place that had a wall all the way around it about that high. There was a block building out in the middle. It was a big house. This was kind of a rich guy's house in Italy. And they come up on it, looking over the edge. It looked like there was nothing there. It's vacant. So they got together and talked about it. So what they did, they moved the guys all the way around it. At a certain time, we'll hit for the thing. So it showed the guy looking at it, okay, it's time, away they went. Well, what happened, they got within about 100 feet of the house, and the Germans popped open some windows and started firing. Well, in all of the movies that I've ever seen made by Americans, they've always used American equipment. But this machine gun was German. And Cal and I were sitting right next to each, on the ends here. Our wives are in the, between us. We were on the floor. People around looked at us like we were drunk. But we'd heard those sounds, and you either reacted or you were dead. And so we got, after we told the wives what happened, and that was it. That went on for probably 10 years. I mean, fortunately, I never heard too many things about it. But yes, for years I would wake up at night and some of the things that I had been involved with came back. But I got older and older. They don't. They still, I'd say about once or twice a year, I won't wake up in horror, but I wake up with that in my mind, with some of those things. But it's not a problem. My only problem is after I got out of the hospital, before they sent me back overseas, I got sent into a psychiatrist. And, I don't know why, but he looked me over and he said, you're okay, son, but he said, I want to tell you one thing. By the time you get to be about 50, your blood balance is going to start causing you all kind of trouble. I laughed at him because I had no problem at that time with it. But when I got about 50, I began to realize when I took my grandsons out to do something, they want to hop, 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 hop. Why can't Grandpa do that? I can't do it. Even if I walk in a place where there's rocks and something like that, I would have to, well, out here. When I came here, I could walk. They had no problem. But this thing out here in front, they wanted us all there for a picture. They wanted me to go back behind. Well, back behind, they had some rocks back there. I tried to step from this one to this one. I couldn't do it. My balance was shot. And since that time, the hip which was damaged, that's why I'm in this darn thing. But you either adjust to it and accept it or else. I've accepted it, so what?
What effect did serving in the military have on your faith?
What effect did being in the military have on what?
Your faith.
My what?
Faith.
Faith? It did two things. One, increased my belief that there is a God that has developed and controls the universe with an infinite number of laws and ways to do it. But I do not believe in most of the ecclesiastical religions that I've known. They're very shallow. They do not get down to understanding. To me, they're making God to be kind of a red skeleton type of person. I think they believe in what they call God, there's no question about that, but their interpretation is very shallow. And so I have some minister friends and we talk a lot about some of this. And I have one Baptist minister that told me not to bother to come back to his church anymore, because I asked him that God created Eve from ribs of Adam in that time. Yes, he believed that. And by golly, I said, well, tell me, how did Adam get there? How did he get there then? He had no mother, no father? Now, so Adam and Eve had two sons. Where did the girls come from that Adam and their two sons married to prolificate the earth? Do you have any idea how long this hunk of stuff has been here? How it got started? Now, from my physics study and working with some other guys that I've known, not working with them, talking to them. Now, there's no definite proof, but there's enough indication that this whole thing was nothing but a huge mass of dust. What it was made up of, I don't know. But they said this dust cloud was every place. It lasted about 2 trillion years. Have you any idea how long a trillion years is?
Long time.
See, you and I will be lucky if we can be on this earth 90 to 100 years. Not just a blink in the eye. Now, and your mom and your dad can back me up on this. If you take a vacation and your mother leaves her dining room table uncovered for a month, come back and what's on the table? You can write your name in it. It's dust, isn't it? Well, that's what this whole space we look out here in is. Now we see clouds and we see blue and this stuff. That wasn't here. It was just dust for 2 trillion years. Now as it begins to collect, as it collects on your tabletop for 2 million years, how did it collect? Well, there's some force in every little particle, so no matter how small it is, that tends to bring it together. It's not a magnetic force, it's an electrical force. And you take $2 trillion, all this stuff, it makes a pretty good hunk of stuff. How big it is, nobody has any idea. But if you pile stuff on your hand, put a book on your hand, you don't hardly feel it. Put another book, start getting this, say, hey, that gets to hurt. Pressure. Squeezing. And suddenly it exploded. The Big Bang Theory, you've heard about many times. How long did that take? It's still going on. Your astroscientists could tell us it out here, this particular constellation. It's moving, it's moving, it's moving. Our constellation, Earth, where we live, it spins every day, which makes us have day and night. But it's also going around the Earth, around the Sun, and it's not this way, it's this way, and spinning. Therefore, the middle part of our Earth, around our, quote, equator, gets more sunlight per year than we do here, or go up north, they get very little sunlight. What's going to happen to the color of the skin? Why do all these gals getting bikinis go over here to the beach in the summertime? They want to tan. Because the more tan they get, they can wink and chew and get a date. See? And so if you do that for 50 million years, what's going to be happening to the skin color of those people who live near the equator where the sun's beating down on them all the time? In your skin and my skin, there are plastids so small we can't even see them with a microscope. They're there. Now, why do you get tanned? What happens? You get tanned. It doesn't burn you, but some of those plastids come up to protect your second level of skin here, which keeps your body from bleeding to death. And after millions of years, that's why the people are black. And if you can think, how did people move in those days? How did you get from here to there? You had to walk. How long would it take you to walk from here to Miami?
A long time.
Overnight? Probably take you 2 weeks, wouldn't it? Well, if you come out of Africa, why did you walk? Why did you move? Why do these animals move from one place to another? Same reason. The Earth can only support a certain amount of life at a certain time. After that, you either starve to death or hunt food someplace else. And so after 50 million years, or 500 million years, or 5 billion years, we don't know. Man walked and walked and walked and walked, not from here to San Francisco, probably not more than 10, 15 miles to find more food, find more food. This group over here was doing the same thing. All of a sudden they come together. What's going to happen? Most of them got in a fight. Half of them got killed. Maybe they got together and this was the smallest group. They're going to force this group to be our slaves. And over a period of time, we have no conception of how long some of this is.
Would you want your son or daughter to join, to enter the military?
Pardon?
Would you want your son or daughter to enter the military?
One side of me says yes. I want them to be, to love liberty as much as our forefathers did, as much as the people going up San Juan Hill. Those of us that are still over there under crosses, they gave their life for it. And I think that that's one of the responsibilities that each of us has, is to make our decision, do we want to be live as free people under a concept of liberty, or do you want to be foot dogs for Hitler, Mussolini, Stalin, Idi Amin, and people like that. You don't have any choice. And so I'm perfectly willing for them to risk their lives to protect what they've had up till now. And that's what bothers me about politicians, is that they have no conception of this. You sit down and talk to the typical politician, his thinking is very shallow. If it wasn't, we wouldn't be in the international mess we're in today. You don't do business with a guy who's irrational. You can't do business with him on a rational basis. He's irrational. Just like a mad dog with rabies. You're not going to pat him on the back and say, be nice, doggy, don't bite. He'll tear your arm off. So from that standpoint, I think they should. I think they should investigate what they want to do, what kind of a part of the military they want to be in. Some of them are rational. Some of them are a little bit scatterbrained. Somebody's got to get down where the shooting is. But now, with the technology that has developed, the invasion that we were in the type of war of World War II will no longer be existence. Now it's going to be big atomic bombs where they can shoot them 5,000 miles from a silo here and hit Berlin by shooting out someplace out of Utah. We got those all over the world. And it depends upon the quality of leadership of each country. And when you look at what's happening in North Korea, those guys are not rational. They're crazy. And it's Stalin himself, Putin, is an intelligent fellow, but he's not deep intelligent. He's intelligent enough to run that country. But he has a desire to be the number one dude in all of Europe and all of Asia and that whole area. Be the first dictator of that whole area. We got them in this country too.
Are you a member of any veteran organizations?
Yeah, pwned all of them.
What are some life lessons you've learned in the military?
Pardon?
What are some life lessons you've learned in the military? What are some life lessons you have learned in the military?
Life lessons? How to get along with almost all people. You don't, if a guy's mad, it doesn't help to get mad too. I've worked with many of, particularly the black boys, who have no father. And the first thing they do is start shouting at each other. I won't shout back. I won't raise my voice to them. I'll let them shout and say, calm down, let's calm down and let's get away from this mob and talk it over. Calm down now. I'm not mad at you. You're mad at somebody, but I don't think you're mad at me. But you would be if I'd argue back with you. He's irrational at that time. There's no logic to him. When I was principal of the high school, if you got sent into the office, I had a fish pond on a little room outside of my office with this, a chair there. You sat there for a while. Watching fish will kind of calm you down. Then you come in and I'd say, John, what's the big problem behind this? This is not your normal way you do things. What has happened to make you this way? Almost all of the cases were not in school. They were from home, the environment where he came from, Some of these kids, they're not lucky like you two guys with your dad here, who really cares about you, or he wouldn't be here. So many of these kids, probably, get the hell out of here. Even little bitty kids. Depends upon all kind of factors, and you don't solve it by being an antagonistic person.
Were you ever wounded?
Pardon?
Were you ever wounded?
Yeah. Yeah, if you go out and look on the wall right out here, there's a case up on the wall about that long, that wide. It's full of World War II stuff. Medals and scouting medals, those are mine. Now my son and my two grandsons are also Eagle Scouts, but they live all over the country, got their own families, and I've asked them if they want it. Oh, they'd be happy to have it. I'll take it, Grandpa. But when they pass on, their grandkids, this is a bunch of junk. So I donated it to the home here. And everything in there is mine, but I've donated it to the... Now the only thing that's not mine, where there's a bunch of artillery pins around the edge that Pam's uncle gave her. But everything in there was mine. And so...
Was there anything I forgot to ask you?
No. I'm sorry I get off on these tantrums, but I'd hate to see either one of you guys getting shot at. Life is too valuable to waste it, as our leadership of our countries have done for thousands of years. You see, if you study a little bit of history, when did man move from the ability just from walking to getting horses to ride? That's not too far back in history. Go back and you won't find much written history about 5,000 years before Christ. 5,000 B.C. There's not much there. Now, there is some Aristotle, Socrates, individuals written in Greek and so forth, but there was no method of transportation that could move people. A horse and a man, they could move. A group of maybe 100 people on horses could move maybe a couple of hundred miles. When did we get boats? We don't know. But where did the boats come from? Basically, they came from the way up north, because they had to get out of the place to get food. And so they were in water, so they started fishing. And I don't know how it happened, but it happened. Somebody got the idea, if we get out deeper, we get bigger fish. And so he got boats. Leif Erikson was probably the first person that discovered this part of the world. But study the geography, the geology of our Earth too. Look at it. Has it always been what you study in geography? Europe, Asia, Africa, North America, South America? Was it always these two big land masses? No, scientists tell us what. Between Europe and America and South America, it's increasing 6 inches a year. Now, 6 inches and 25,000 miles is insignificant to you and I, but over a period of 1,000 years, it can be quite a distance. And if you look at it carefully, you can see that the general shape of North America, South America, how it would fit together into one country, one landmass over here. We don't know whether it was exactly that way or start, we don't know. But we do know that there has been many of volcano eruptions and things that have happened that make the ones that we've seen in our lifetime look like firecrackers. They finally discovered, you've heard about the tsunamis, how the ocean suddenly, huge waves come on land. When you were little boys over here in South Asia, they had one, killed thousands of people, just wiped them out. They could never find out, and they had one in Japan and just about destroyed Japan. And they called it the tsunami, the magic wave. They never knew what happened, but one college professor geologist did. Studying all kind of stuff, I suppose. He discovered by, he walked from the middle of California all the way up to Alaska, studying the ground, taking samples and samples and samples, studying the ocean depth there. And you come up on that point, the ocean goes down like this, not like this. It goes zoom. And what he discovered, and it's proven it now, is that a piece of land from about Oregon all the way up to pretty close to Alaska, this whole land mass just went boop. And what happens if you drop something heavy in water?
Waves.
Yeah. And so it just shoved all that water over and hit Japan and just about wiped half of Japan out. But it's still happening. It happened about 40 years ago. No, not that far ago. In southeastern Asia. And killed many, many hundred people over there. Everybody was living on the beach. Just got wiped out. And so we don't know what's going to happen. There's no guarantees, even though the politicians will tell you, vote for me and I'll guarantee you don't have to do these things. There's no guarantee. There's no guarantee I'll be alive this afternoon. I'm hoping you two guys have a rich life as I've had. But, all you can do is get yourself the best prepared as an individual and live the best life that you can live as an individual, and keeping your mind open not to be suckered in by all this stuff that's coming out of Washington. Right now, the biggest ripoff is using now TV artists to sell this reverse mortgage. You stop and think about it. It's a lie. It's a ripoff. Now, if somebody comes to you and says, you buy a car, you borrow money from this fellow to buy the car, $20,000. Okay, you pay 5 years, you paid half of it back. Government comes along and says, hey, you got an equity in that car. You don't own the car. He does. It's his money that bought the car, not yours. Now, if you would be trying this to be a reverse payment to the mortgage, we call it a payment, we will give you that money because you've got $5,000 into that car. we'll give you $5,000. You can do anything you want with that. You can pay him off, and then the car is yours. But there'll be no more payment. No more mortgage payments. They're advertising this. No more mortgage payments. They're not saying no more mortgage payments to him. They're saying to you, no more mortgage payments. Hey, you're getting $50,000 now for nothing. The only stipulation they put in is that when you die, then the property becomes this group here. That's Uncle Sam. What's he doing? Well, look at who gave you this money. My party did. You got to vote for us now or we won't have a chance. We'll have to stop this program. So I tie you into my political party. That's how politicians work. They appeal to your weakness, not to your strength. That's history. If you want to study something that's really disgusting, really study political history as far back as they can discover it. Well, good luck on your thing here, whatever, however you're doing it. Wish you all luck in the world.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was an amazing interview.
Where's your troop at here in Ocala?
Mm-hmm.
Well, when you get to you become your ego, why, let me know. I'd like to try to get in to see it.
All right. Thank you.